I have with me Jacob Rees-Mogg, the leader of the Brexit grouping within the Conservative Party European Research Group. Mr. Rees-Mogg, thank you. So you've essentially won that vote, but what do you think of this written ministerial statement compromise made by the government?
I think from this process, everybody has emerged with credit and there's a good deal of goodwill. I pay particular tribute to Dominic Grieve, who was willing to listen and engage and get a good deal of what he was asking for. But crucially, the government has got its business, it's got its bill through intact, and the written ministerial statement restates what is the expected parliamentary situation. That, of course, the House of Commons can debate motions, opposition days, backbench business days, government motions, as it sees fit.
So do you concede that this meaningful vote, I mean, it's hypothetical, isn't it? But imagine it does happen. There is a route through which this Commons could make that an amendable motion.
I don't think that's right. I think Article 24B of Standing Orders says that a motion put down in neutral terms cannot be amended. And the Speaker will follow the norms of parliamentary procedure and will not take a cavalier and high-handed approach to that.
So some of the Remainers are saying, well, it's up to the House of Commons to decide whether to disregard standing orders from time to time. That seems to be what they're basing this compromise on.
Standing orders can be changed, but the Speaker can't and would not unilaterally disregard them. That would be improper, and the Speaker has always been very good at behaving properly. The key issue, though, is that what this has done is that it has meant that any vote in the House of Commons on the deal will have a political rather than a legal effect. And that's quite right, because the House of Commons is here to have a political effect, to show it's got confidence in the government or not, but only legislation should have the full weight of law behind it. So I think from what has happened today, we've seen a reassertion of the proper constitutional procedures, and that the government has therefore got its business on that basis. And it's good for the government to have done this.
Because can you accept that if this does get to a situation in January where no deal is a possibility, that the Commons will want to not just have a say, but will want to be able to do more than that on what would be a massive potential change to the way the economy works and the way our constitution works, to leave with no deal?
The basic constitutional principle is that the government of the day has to command a majority in the House of Commons. If the government came back in such a way that the Commons no longer had confidence in it because the negotiations had failed, then the House of Commons has a route to do that and always has had.
A confidence motion to bring down the government?
Or a motion short of a confidence motion that encourages the government to do something different. I quoted in my speech the Norway debate. Yeah. The government won the vote on Norway, but it still had a profound effect on the makeup of the government, because what the House of Commons does has political effect, and that's always the case, and that's completely irrelevant to today's debate. Today's debate was about the withdrawal bill, which gets through in the way the government needed it to get through. So in that sense, the government has done very well.
So take a step back from this. Isn't it incredible that we're spending all this time negotiating the procedure for a hypothetical vote that probably won't happen, at the very moment when the European Commission is publishing dozens of preparedness statements about no deal? We've had zero preparedness statements from DexEU. I mean, it does seem to be something of a disconnect. We're talking to ourselves and not getting this sorted.
I think the issue there is that you've got to think about what the government is doing and what Parliament is doing. The job of Parliament is to ensure that the legislative procedures and the standing orders are in place to ensure that any political circumstance can be dealt with. The government's job, the executive job, is to get on with the details of negotiations and planning, all of which is going on, and there will be a white paper soon setting out what's happened, and there will be negotiations in June. But this means the Prime Minister goes to those negotiations in June with full strength, with the ability to say the legislation to leave the EU under EU law and under UK law is now fully in place.
And you will support her in the compromises she will need to make to come back from Brussels with a deal. Will you support her now?
Thank you. Well, you're asking me to write out a blank cheque. I don't think my bank manager would approve of me writing out blank cheques.
Well, you've just asked the Commons to write a blank cheque, haven't you?
No, come to ask the Commons to write out a blank cheque. Once again, you're not focusing on the ability of the Commons to vote on whatever it wants, whenever it wants. That is our normal constitutional position, and for the government of the day to command a majority in the House of Commons to remain the government. That's therefore never a blank cheque. It is always the government is accountable and the Commons is there to hold it to account.
Jacob Rees-Mogg, thank you very much for joining us.